I'm a toy maker. I've been making toys for 35 years. And maybe I could dispense with this because there are not too many people. I'm a street performer, so I don't need a mic. Thank you very much for coming. I'm a product of IIT Kanpur. I entered IIT Kanpur in 1970. Those were politically very volatile days. There was the all kinds of movements throughout the world. Rachel Carson had written The Silent Spring, which ushered the environment movement. You had the anti-Vietnam movement in the US. In India, you had the Naxal movement, you had the Jai Prakash Narayan movement. Whenever there is a political churning of society, a lot of social energy is released. A lot of our scientists decided that they're not going to be involved in making bombs. We can't do any good to humanity, we must not do any harm. So some of them seriously rethought what should be their social roles. One was Anil Sadgopal, did a PhD from Caltech, a molecular biologist, worked in the TIFR. He used to work with Ubaid Siddiqui, the person who founded the roots of biotechnology in the country, fellow of the Royal Society. And Anil was about 31 years old. And those were very different times. And whatever esoteric research he was doing, he was not able to relate it to the lives of the ordinary people. So he chucked his job. One of the first NGOs in 1970 called as Kishore Bharat. He went to a village in Madhya Pradesh called Paria Piparia. If you pass through Itarsi, Itarsi comes from Hoshangabad district. It's almost Nagpur and Itarsi are the epicenters of India. The way that science was taught in village schools was terribly mutilating. Children mug up definitions and spit it out in the exams. No child did any experiments. And this was, they said, the very bad way of learning science. So the story started an activity-based science program. The purpose was to revitalize primary science in village schools and try to use as far as possible very simple material available in the village. Sometimes batteries, magnets and bulbs need to be bought from outside, but try and see possibilities, look critically at what is available in the village and try and use this. Not very easy, very challenging. The first teacher trainer was a very renaissance scientist, Professor Yashpal, PhD from the MIT, a person who has worn many hats, chairman of the UGC, chairman, secretary general of the DST, all kinds of Padma Vibhushan, the highest UNESCO award for popular science, the Kalinga award. He came as the first teacher. In 75, after doing my BTech, I came to Pune. I used to work at Telco, called as Tata Motors now. And 2 years, excellent training. I love Telco. I'm a tinkerer by heart. For all my life, I made things. So I love Telco because it was doing things with your hands. But after 2 years, I just thought that I was not one to make drugs. And I took a year off, went to Kishore. And when I was, this is what I said that, Kanpur is very far up, Pune is very far up. So there is a village hut, a weekly. Come closer, please. Come closer. I can't come any closer. Please come over here. There's a lot of space over here. The mic doesn't work, so. And now I'd be handicapped. I'd be showing things with both my hands so I can't hold the mic. So please bear with me, come close by. It's always good to fix things with the strip a little bit more. Right? And I was getting my bike inflated. I bought everything sold on the roadside. There would be small mirrors, bangles, tickleys, bindis. I was getting my bike inflated. And there is something black over here. You can see all these model surveys. This is called a cycle valve tube, where you actually inflate your bicycle. You might need a small piece, might cost you a rupee, but this is sold by weight. You can get a 100 gram packet of the cycle valve tube, which costs 25 rupees in Pune, which is 50 feet of this. Something, if there is a mechanical contraption, which has reached all our villages, only the bicycle holds this glory of place. And matchsticks, if you don't have a matchbox, you can't light the home fire. So we're not talking about fancy things. Remove the sulfur, so the same thickness on both the ends, and the matchstick goes in very snugly. Two matchsticks, they meet head on, and what you make is a flexible joint of two lines. And we start by teaching angles. The acute angle, the right angle, the obtuse angle, straight angle, reflex angle. From 0 degrees to 360 degrees, you could depict any angle. It was like a universal coupling. You could transmit drive at any angle. If you have three of them, you can make a triangle, a square, a pentagon. You can make all these kinds of polygons, and they have some very, very interesting properties. If you look at the hexagon, for instance, these are all flexible joints. If you just pull the hexagon, you made a rectangle, push it in, you make a parallelogram, but it's like an amoeba, which is constantly changing its outer profile. The pentagon might look very regular, but you pull it out, it becomes like a boat shape, a trapezium. Push it in, it becomes a house shape, an isosceles triangle, but nonetheless very, very shaped. The square may look very square in print, all 90 degrees, give it a push, this becomes a rhombus. But then you see a child, a triangle, and no matter what she does, you can't do a thing to a triangle. This is the bedrock of all civil and mechanical engineering. The engineers, the scientists learnt it from the ordinary people. People have been living in houses for thousands of years, and no one ever makes a house crust like this, because if you put tiles on top, it's just going to collapse. House crusts are always triangles, because triangles take the beating. You can't make a bridge with square members, because if the train would come and start doing a jig, the bridge. No use. No, it was very nice, because the child could actually hold the concept in her hand, feel the concept. Now, these are all joints. If you were to take a third matchstick and you make the hole over here with the thorn and push the third matchstick, you get a T joint or a joint of three. And if you were to embed all the three legs of this tripod in the three vertices of the triangle, you would get a very beautiful test. So you could make the three dimensional shapes. If you made a prism, you could put this on top of this. And you could make a joint of six, you could make a joint of four, five. And children's fingers are so dexterous that they can easily make a joint of 12. Now, with matchsticks, the basic numbers, a joint from 2, 4, 6, 8, 12, there is a whole world for you to design. And well, very simply, just take the tetrahedron, for instance, put four marbles. And there is an orange bead inside, if you can see. You simulate the molecular structure of methane, CH4, four atoms with hydrogen, at the four corners of the tetrahedron, it between is a carbonate. I was about 25 years old at that time, very young engineer, and I thought it gave me the high, so to say. Now you need to get a high somehow, that this is much better than designing trucks. And I've just stuck to it ever since. Yes, yeah. Can I hold it? You can hold it.
Arvind ji says that the best thing a child can do with a toy is to?
We have a slogan that the best thing a child, it's a very anarchistic slogan, the best thing a child can do in the world is to break it. Children are not born terrorists, because they're very so different from adults, because they're the only people who want to know what is inside the tummy of the toy. So until they go to the intestines, and that's how they learn. So a good design toy should be designed so that children can rip it apart and put it back again. And I'll give you several examples of this. This one is a very classic example. Here is a You could actually blow up the balloon and pop it. It's a very, very popular toy. Well, this is an old film can that they're disappearing now, because everyone can take the photographs with mobile phones and digital cameras, but this is a humble. And the discovery is that this film can goes very snugly into old bicycle tubes. And what we have done over here is you can see there's a small hole. There's a hole over here and a flap. If I blow, air can pass through. Can I suck in? I can't suck in. So this is like a traffic light. This is green light and this is red light. It's one-way traffic, and that's what a valve is. The electronic equivalent is the diode of a valve, but this is a mechanical valve. Then you can get a very good feel of it. This is my suction valve. This is the bellows. Another film can with the lid. A second valve. This is the delivery valve. And then you just put a straw. So this is exactly what I meant by a great toy, which you can rip apart and put it back again. And they're never going to forget as to how a pump works. Because now the cat is out of the bag, the mystique is all gone. They can see and get a very good feel. Now this is a very, very nice pump. I'm going to show you some more pumps. This is a very, very nice pump. And all you just need is a straw, ordinary paper, ordinary plastic straw. This is a broomstick, a thick broomstick, which you poke in the center. Leave about two finger widths, make a half cut to the right and a half to the left. So these both these arms can swivel, you can bend them, and then take a sticky tape and wrap it around like a belt. And this is, it's a 2 minute toy, and this is what we get. And this is a very, very amazing toy. If I were to just dip it in a jug of water and just spin, it's an amazing sense. This artificial rain. I think they're called for it. Imagine children of class 2, class 1, you know, watering small pots. The first elements, the first steps in science should be extremely joyous steps. It's a great centrifuge. If you spin something, it tends to fly out. And for both these plants, water climbs in and comes out from these guts. So it's a very, very nice story. This is another toy. If a child can see a principle of science in a toy, it's much less frightening to a child. It goes straight to the heart. And within play, you know, it's very adult arrogance that we teach. Children were born to learn. We put so many hurdles in their way that they've stopped learning. And all they learn is usually silly stuff in the school. How many years you spend in a school without learning anything worthwhile? If you just reflect in your own lives, you don't have to go very far off. But this is a very old traditional toy. If you were in Andhra Pradesh, it would be made of the palmyra leaf. And you could buy it in a village fair. But here's the acrobat, Mr. Acrobat. This is the head and the body are doubled over here. And you can see there is a small crevice where there is the shoulder and these. And how do you attach them? You push the shoulder in with a needle and a thread. A knot here and a knot here. That's all. That's what constitutes the hinges. So the hands and legs can move. And if I just... If I were to spin it with both hands, this is Mr. Flying Man. This is a great centrifuge. If you spin something, they tend to fly out. And this is exactly what's happening here. I think if science was taught in a fun manner, it would go to the children's hearts. This is just an ordinary straw, and I just press so that to flatten it. And then I've just cut two slots. And if you see from the side, it looks like a baby crocodile's mouth. It's like a reed, R-E-E-D, and I just need to press it a little bit more. I keep about 2 inches in my mouth, and I blow my lungs out. It makes a mighty racket, all right? You're not able to see how the sound is produced, because the part that's actually producing the sound was hidden in my mouth. I can keep this outside, and instead of blowing out air, I need to suck in air. Now see very carefully, what's happening? It's vibrating. We don't need to mug up, therefore production of sound that you require vibrations to actually feel, see it. And what you experience with all your senses goes much more to the heart than just words, plain words. Later on, you go home and blow it. Well, I can make a couple of holes. And more, well, you come very close to a flute. But one very nice, very, very, very interesting thing which you can do is keep blowing at it, keep making the noise, and keep cutting the string. Experience all the 7 notes with a small straw, how a flute works, you get a very good qualitative feel for it. We saw that the longer the straw, the lower the pitch. And the shorter, the pitch goes higher and higher until you have the smallest reed left and with a very high pitch. Very high pitch. And this is what children taught us. If you learn nothing out of this workshop, just this, I think, is good enough. We've all made noise like this as children. So this is a very, very good. Well, this toy has been around for 100 years. You take a pencil with a rubber on one end. There's a fan from a card sheet and a big hole in the middle. You can see that there is a pin. It's loose over here. There's a bit of a play. Push a pin inside the rubber. This white rubber is like a stopper. Otherwise the fan might fly away. So this life is stopped. What I hold in my hand is a old ball pen reader. These are very precious things not to be thrown. And you can see that there are 7-8 notches over here, V-shaped notches. So 7-8 notches over here. I'm just going to rub, I'm going to hold it not far off, but very close and rub it hard on the notches. Something amazing happens. This has been a darling of physicists for the last 100 years. It's non-trivial physics. It's really complex physics. That's why you will not find the NCERT books. But all the children over here, I think if you learn only one toy, it is this toy you must learn, because this should be part of a geometry box. When the teacher is breathing down your neck, you should be writing. And when the teacher turns her back, this is what you were born to do. Each one of us was born to do this. I think play is very serious business. I've been extremely fortunate. I've played my entire life and earned a living. Not working in offices like this, but just earned a living playing the whole day. I think play is very serious. People who play as children don't make bombs, don't make missiles, because they're happy people. They don't want to harm anyone. This is very, very serious. Often people say this is not part of the curriculum. All curriculums are political, all curriculums are narrow. So never stick to a curriculum. The clever people, Mark Twain said this 150 years back, do not let schools interfere with your education. Education is much more serious than what schools can ever give. So clever people set their own benchmarks and they work on them. They don't let schools interfere with their education, but we have an answer for that. Now this is a similar kind of toy. Instead of the fan, a rectangular fan, we have a circular disc. You can see there are 7 colors, which are the colors of Newton's disk. And once again, if I rub this because of the vibrations, this disk will start to split. All the 7 colors will coalesce and you see a kind of a grayish white. Not a pure white, because these are colors from sketch pens. They're not true colors to start with, but some kind of. You don't need a battery, you don't need a motor for doing this, but very nice. This is the simplest motor on earth. In all our houses, modern life would come to a standstill without a motor. With the motor is in the fan. I can't see any fans over here, but in my house there'd be a fan. It's in the cooler, it's in the mixie, it's in the washing machine, it's in the air conditioner. The motor drives a pump which pumps water to the overhead tank. If you were to make a list, you can, all drives and computers are run by motors. So there'd be a dozen motors we use at home. Rare is a child who ever makes a motor. Which just shows the mutilation in school education. You mug up and you spit out. You get 95%, but you actually learned very little. And one must question this kind of a learning. So we've been making this for 25 years. The most expensive thing, as you can see, is the battery. The battery is not a drained out battery, otherwise it would be black magic. This is science. For any output, you need an input. So the input comes from the battery. If there's a power cut, well, it will be a blackout over here. But this, you can see, is a battery. These are 2 safety pins. This is a whole bicycle tube which gives you a broad rubber band. So they are snug to the plus and the minus of the battery, 1.5 volts across this. If I were to attach a torch bulb, it's going to glow. Not burn very brightly, but glow nonetheless. This is a small ferrite, 50, 60 paisa, 1 rupee each. Here is a 1 meter coil. Now this is the simplest motor on earth. It takes less than 10 minutes to make a motor like this. And children can do a whole range of experiments with this. If instead of a battery, I put 2 batteries in series, it'd be 3 volts. What difference would it make to the performance of the motor? Instead of 1 meter wire, if I use 2 meters of wire, half meter wire, thicker wire, thinner wire, if I change the air gap between the motor and the coil, that's very crucial to the working of the motor. If I bring another magnet on top, if this is the north, if I bring the north, similar pole, what happens? If I bring the south, what happens? Now children can mess around with this and they get a very good feel as to what goes into making a more efficient motor. This is not a rich man's game. If you have the battery at home, it costs less than 5 rupees to make a motor like that. So, literally lakhs of children have made this motor from a website. It's a brilliant motor. And all the Faraday's laws which you've learned as theory are going to just fall into place. that start making sense to you. So well, the motor is but something even which goes beyond the motor, and which is the... Now this is medical technology. We live in a world of junk. New technologies means newer junk. There is, you know, Ayuka, where I work, is a quite a high-tech government institute. It does research in astrophysics and astronomy. And they said that after a couple of years, we'd become a paperless office. But there's something in high technology that you require more paper than ever before, right? They are paper guzzlers. This is medical technology. It's been throwing away so much of junk. This is an old syringe. You have nothing to do with the needle part of it, just the plastic syringe. These are very strong magnets. These are called as neodymium magnets. But look at the periodic table. There is an element called as NP, a rare earth element. China has the largest reserves of the rare earths, and they're sitting put on it. And they're the largest suppliers of magnets in the world. And these are neodymium magnets, and they go into the barrel very easily, and they can reciprocate. It can move. And this is a slight rubber stopper. That's it. Now, on top of it, I take thin insulated copper wire, which is used for motor rewinding, 36 gauge, 1,000 tons. From start to end, it takes half an hour. Scrape both the ends, and you attach a LED. That's it. And if I just move the magnets, what do I see? This is a syringe torch. I'm generating electricity to be able to power this LED. This is one of the most popular videos on our website because it's very doable, half an hour, seventh class children, literally tens of thousands of children. There's nothing which can go wrong over here. Very bad. Imagine a child in a village in UP or in Bihar makes a torch like that. Imagine the joy in a girl's eyes that today I'm able to light a LED, tomorrow I light up my whole village. It's a shift in paradigm. It empowers the child. And all the laws, because this is exactly, there's a moving magnetic field inside a coil which generates an EMF. So whatever Faraday said, you can actually see it startling. So we need both theory and practice. Without practice, science is lame. And without theory, it can't go forward. So we require both of them. And very, very doable kind of things. This is the, nowadays, if you want a plumber to set up to fix a new tap for you, they used to use on the threads of the pipe, they would wrap, put white paint and put some jute to prevent leakage. Nowadays, use Teflon tape. This is the empty spool. The Teflon tape cost 12 rupees. This is the empty spool which is thrown away. 1,000 turns of wire and LED. This is my electrical circuit. This is the outer cover. We put two paper clips, tape them. This green is a tape. Pass a cycle spoke, and there you can see these are two strong magnets. This is my magnetic circuit. Now separately they do very little, but if you bring them closer, well, they do magic. Now you can see this is the coil. The magnets are going to rotate at right angles to the coil. And they're not connected in any way through wires, because magnetic fields is a very powerful, invisible force. And when there's a spinning magnetic field, you can actually see that you are able to produce an EMF and light up a LED. Well, this is an amazing piece. It's from a model, it's a 3D model, and made from paper. And it's, you could rotate the paper. Right now what you see is, you see butterflies, you see frogs, snakes, eagles. Butterflies, frogs, snakes, eagles, butterflies. Four pictures coming in a sequence, one after the other. And if you have these four pictures, you can weave a story in them. That butterflies are insects, insects are eaten by the frogs, frogs are eaten by the snakes, snakes are eaten by the eagles. Science is full of such wonderful stories. Cycles, chains, this is the food chain, but you could have the water cycle, this is the rain cycle. We know that the sun is the source of all the heat. It's the sun's heat which leads to evaporation water, and then we get clouds. It's the clouds which bring about rain, precipitation. Once it rains, all the reservoirs are repleted with water, and the sun is back once again, evaporating water, making clouds, bringing rain. So this is the typical rain cycle. Another one, which, it's a 14-page, it's a rotating mathematical model. It's a 14-page unending book. You see 1, 2, 3, 4. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. 14 is the last page, and we start once again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. 1, 2, 3, 4. Just need two squares and a bit. Very clever hinges. Imagine, Shufa, every child has a favorite story, which you can predict. You can tell that story to them, read them that story aloud 50 times, and they don't get bored because it's their favorite story. So they can divide the story into 14 steps and illustrate, make a picture for themselves. You might go to any mall, you can't buy a toy like this. You can only buy stupid toys. The cleverest toys are always made. And the best toys on earth because they are a fruit of your own labor. You have made them. Very, very nice. Just two squares and a bit of glue. Less than 3 minutes to make it. And we have made small films of this, 1 or 2 minute videos in 18 languages. We tried to find partners wherever we could to dub them into. Luckily, we found an amazing person. Her name is Dr. Breezy Okana Flacker from the Dominican Republic. She came to Pune University as a postdoc scholar. And the first week she came to our center and she said, this is what my children need. I come from such a poor country. Dominican Republic is next to Haiti, one of the most poorest countries in the world, in the Caribbean. And today she has dubbed 350 films into Spanish, which is a mother tongue. The result is that millions of kids across Latin America have seen our videos. So this is the whole purpose, to design teaching aids, to make science exciting for the poorest children on earth. But before I go any further, this is the best thing that I can share with you. This is not designed by us, but we have popcorn. It's something, it's called as a touching slate. It's a slate meant for blind children. And you can't imagine the number of blind children in this country. There is a factory out there which is making our children blind. 13 million blind children. Imagine the population of Mumbai, which is very close to 13 million. That's the extent. Imagine each and every man, woman, child in Mumbai can't see. Now this is my slate, and this is the Velcro. Velcro's got two strips of nylon, one with hooks, the other with loops, and they stick together. This is only the hook part, the loop part we discussed. So there are millions of nylon hooks. This is my drawing slate, and this is my drawing pen, which is essentially like a fishing line. This is a bottle, a piece of rubber slipper, and a pen. So the purpose of the rubber is to put the bottle and the pen together. Here is a bicycle spoke painted to a Z shape like a crank, and you put a eraser inside, gouge out some of the rubber, so this is an improvised pulley, and then you just put this inside. Now this is like a fishing line. If I crank the handle, you can see that all the wool gets wrapped up. And wool has a lot of fibers. And a blind child can just draw on it. And then whatever they want, they can feel in their hands. For the first time, blind children could actually draw and feel themselves. They can learn drawing without any help. Just 2 years back, from our website, there was a teacher in Thailand, teacher Chacha. He used to work in a special school. He made these slates for all the blind children of school. And there was a big coverage in the media about this. He got a corporate sponsorship to make these Velcro slates for all the blind schools in Thailand. So this is very, very simple. And the simplicity is that this wool sticks on Velcro. Well, we make a lot of toys from paper. All newspapers, Outlook, Frontline, all these magazines, you cut little squares. And if you had a square and just fold this up, you get a big triangle. Fold this again and you get a small triangle. And this looks like the letter V, V for van, V for victory, like the 2 years of an animal. And all I'm just going to do is to just tear it. Make two rounded and long ears. And fold this to the front and fold this to the back. And this is the 32nd, this is Mr. Rabbit. Rabbit's mouth, rabbit's long ears, his front legs. I'm just holding the body, just the legs, just below the body, grab the tail and move the tail forwards and backwards, and it's a very, children have been making it for literally hundreds of years. It's a very dynamic. The poorest child can afford it. all the Barbies, He-Man, Skull-Man, these very sexist, violent toys, unsustainable. Well, I'll not be here 20 years down, nor will these toys be. They would have disappeared from the face. They are just unsustainable. Agar aap aaj khilona khareedte hain to dabba mehenga hota hai, khilona sasta hota hai. This is modernization, right? But this is a very good case. Well, if you took another square, a similar square, and this is just the square, no scissors, and you make a flapping bird. It's called a bird of peace, and just the square in your tender fingers. No glue, no scissors. And this is the documented history of 300 years. This is origami, which is, you know, it's woven into the Japanese religious rituals, like in Dashera, Diwali. We eat sweetmeats and then the whole family sits. And in Japan, the whole family sits in false paper. And that's how this art has been kept alive for 300 years. This is an Oriental society. We don't seem to learn anything from them. Documented for 300 years, nothing new about this. And it just tells you the hollowness of our own schools. The children waste 17 years just about learning nothing worthwhile. And what did it was? This was the bird. And this we did about 20 years back. Same bird. This is a ball pin reefle and a pin rotating inside. So the reefle is the bush of the bearing and the pin is the accent. Take a little strip of paper. It's a fantail bird. And you can just see this. It's aerodynamic, it's eco-friendly. If you have a whole reefle, you could then make 10 of these birds. They don't burn a hole in your pocket. Whether you're a child, whether you're an adult, whether you're an old man, everyone can play with it. At various levels, it would give you some benefit. Very amazing. It also makes a bit of noise, but it's a very sturdy bird. A very simple toy. It's like just using two broomsticks, you make a bow. This is an old sketch pen. You make a hole and you just weave the thread. This is a reefle, and we have just stuck a card sheet. You see a cage on one side, a bird on the other. And, well, this many children try out as children when they're very small, that this is like the bird in the cage. It's like persistent vision. My hands are like a machine. They convert straight line motion into rotary motion. My palms are moving in a straight line, but the reefle is going. This is the first mixer or juicer, if I were to use it down below. Well, I can make buttermilk. This is the first mixer juicer. But this is a very, very fine machine because I just removed the thread with the help of the reefle. The arrow is towards you. I'm going to just give it half a rotation. And you can see there's a cross in the thread. And then I'll put the reefle inside. Now the thread is going inside the magenta ball pen, taking the round of the reefle. What you see right now is the parrot. Now the cage, the parrot in the cage. And if you move it fast enough, it's the bird. Beautiful machine converts straight line motion into rotary motion. And of course, if you're not interested in science, it's not the end of the world. You can do something more interesting. This is a very, very beautiful. There is a book called The Joy of Making Indian Toys by Sudarshan Khanna. Sudarshan taught at the NID for 35 years, National Institute of Design in Ahmedabad, the premier design institute in the country. You take a long broomstick and a short broomstick, and you tie them tightly with a thread. The short piece is slightly bent down. This is an acute angle, this is an obtuse angle. Then you can take a baby coconut and just poke it. It's difficult to get hold of baby coconuts in Pune, so the substitute is take a old rubber slipper and just poke it in. You need some weight over here. And if I just perch with my index finger, this is the big side, this is the small side, and you spin it like this. This is like the Sudarshan Chakra. No, centrifugal force, centripetal force are big birds for little children. Ek kaan se sunte hain, dusre kaan se kachra pe. Because all these big concepts, you need activities to make sense. Then they start making sense. There is a sequel to this, and this is very, very nice. This was designed by a fourth class boy. And he got a small award for this. And this is a similar toy. You can just see structurally very, very similar. Only thing that there are two cross members over here, and he's put some aluminum foil. Make a guess what this boy did. No, not a bird.
Fan?
Not a fan, something which spins.
A dog.
Imagine this. Look at this, is spinning in space. What could this be?
Satellite.
Satellite, that's right. Well, these are the solar panels. Up in space, you can't be taking batteries because they will get drained out, but the sun is shining 24/7. So you generate your own power to operate all the controls and beam back messages on Earth. So for the little boy, this is like a satellite. Very nice. This we designed about 8-9 years back, and this has become very, very popular. These are ring magnets, like this, ring magnets. And they, on a rubber, you put four of them, and two on this pencil. You can see two on this pencil. The front ones attract. So the opposite poles. The rear ones are similar poles to the repel. And because they repel, they lift the pencil up. The front ones, because they attract, they pull the pencil. So I can just perch this entire pencil on my fingertip. It's just hanging in the air on my fingertip. This is the old CD. This is modern junk, and you can cut it with the scissors very easily. It's very smooth. And so this becomes the pivot. This is my finger. There'll be much less friction over here. And it spins. It levitates. And it writes. It's a levitating pencil, and 7 years back, there's a very, very bright girl in Ayuka. The brightest physicist is Professor T. Padmanabhan. Infosys, as you know, instituted basic science awards 5 years back, and these awards are not, they're very huge, 50 lakh rupees. And the first award was won by Paddy. He's a daughter, her name is Hamsa Padmanabhan. We went to no fancy school, the Kendriya Vidyalaya across the road in Ganeshkin, extremely bright. When she was in ninth, she was just quizzed by this story. She wrote a 12-page mathematical paper on this, what are the stabilities. Second Intel International Award. She was lifted from Pune to Seattle, won the second $2,000. The American Association of Physics Teachers were so zapped by what this girl had done, they gave another $2,000. If you just Google Hamsa Padmanabhan, today a minor planet is named after Hamsa. And I think this is the potential of every girl in this country. Gone are the days of the whites when they said that they are brighter than the brown man, or the black man, and we must just throw it. The genome project only demonstrated that 99.99% of our genes are the same, and we are as good or as bad as anyone else in the world. But no, but we can look anyone in the eye. As a matter of fact, I get a dozen emails from American teachers every single day. We have 31 pumps on our website. No one makes 31 pumps in the world. That for the first time, my children actually understood how pumps work. I just showed you two, but there are 31. One is that we use a lot of old newspapers for making caps. And this is a very, very favorite cap for all children. Half a newspaper, and this is Sachin Tendulkar's cricket cap. It's a very, very cool cap. Whenever children are folding paper, it's like a geometry laboratory for them. Because all the angles and polygons which they talk in the abstract, they actually fold it and they make something very, very nice. And if one child makes it, the whole class wants to make it. There's a peer pressure. So this is we make a dozen caps. I'm just going to show you two, three of them. This is, of course, Anna stole it from us. We've been making it for the last 20 years. Just half, it's an old Gandhi cap. Very, very easy to make. And I just tell you a story in the end. And this story is called as the captain's hat story. If you've not heard about this, is Captain Gopi Shankar, who was a captain of a sea-going ship. And we know that whenever people go onto the sea for a long voyage, it takes them several weeks, several months before they reach their destination because the ship sails very, very slowly. The first few days are very happy because it's the first to join into the sea. But after a couple of days, all they see is the blue, wide ocean, not a patch of land, not a tree, and they become bored, they become seasick. Now, Gopi Shankar was a very clever captain. He saw the passengers getting bored, so he invited them on the deck and said, you sing and dance the whole day. Enjoy yourself, I'll provide you with food and drinks. Gopi Shankar had a suitcase full of different kinds of caps, and he would join the regalia every day. And this is the first cap. It's like a huge umbrella cap. If the captain is standing on the deck, it protects him from the scorching sun, protects him from the rain. And at night, when all the passengers would go to sleep, he would take the same cap and give it one more fold. And the second day, well, he'd be wearing a, this like a, you've seen the firemen, the fire brigade people wear a very special designer cap because they go into a burning house, work under very hazardous circumstances. If some rubble falls from the top, it must protect the spinal cord. So they have a chute at the back. It's a very designer cap meant for the firemen. Second night, he would take the same cap and put, give it one more fold, and this is a shikari cap. It's like an adventurous cap. It's like a Robin Hood cap, cap number three. And the third night, he would take the same cap and give it two more folds. And this is the most famous cap of it all. We are very close to Mumbai, which is the Bollywood film industry. We make over 1,000 films, and our films are appreciated the world over because of all the interesting things they have in them. And we've seen any of your Bollywood films, the policeman, the cop always wears a cap like this. It's called as the Pandu cap. This has been catapulted to international glory. So for this, the Pandu cap. Remember, if you can recall all the four caps, tell me which is the first cap. It's the huge umbrella cap. Second one? Fireman's cap. Third cap? Shikari cap. And fourth is this Pandu cap. And we must not forget that Gopi Shankar, after all, he was a captain of a ship. And so this is the one ship. And everyone was enjoying the journey very much. And suddenly there's a huge storm. Chaka chong bijli chamakti hai, dhuaan dhaar baarish aati hai. The sea is on fire. Huge waves. And what can the poor ship do? It rocks and pitches along with the waves. And then a huge wave comes and slaps the aft of the ship and just knocks it down. And all the passengers are terrified that we have come for a picnic and here the ship is broken in two pieces. And then another huge wave comes and slaps the front portion of the ship. Now the ship is broken to smithereens, pieces, and it's sinking. The triangular portion of the ship is called as a bridge. In Urdu, I have said that the bala is not here. And a third huge wave comes and slaps the bridge and just knocks it down. Now, jahaz ke tukde tukde ho jate hain. Jahaz doob jata hai. Topi Shankar bichara doob jata hai. Kuch nahi bachta uske paas mein. Ek phati purani baniyan ya life vest. There are a couple of other things in the but not just this, we have separately, we work, I work in science, but there are other people who make extremely, this is a mother and a child. This is from old boxes which are thrown away, which we get. And this is the mother, and so it's a three-dimensional sculpture of mother and a child. Recently, we just celebrated our 10th birthday of our center, and then my friends made 120 of these small. This is the fruity straw inside a normal straw. So it's a very simple toy. But something which is dynamic, which moves, and is able to captivate the attention. And I think the last thing which I will show you, because it's very, very significant. This is this builder. This particular toy was made by a girl. Her name is Durga Jetties. Inside the Pune University, the Pune University is a huge mass of land, 411 acres. Pune University used to be the British governor's summer residence, and someone got good sense to convert this beautiful place into a university 50 years back. There is, just next to the university main gate, is a school. That's a neighborhood school. The only school in the university is called as a Vidyapeetha, run by the Karve Shikshan Sanstha, and there are 2,500 children. It's like a municipal, huge municipal school. A girl, her name is Durga. She lives in a slum. Father is a drunkard. Durga washes dishes in four houses with her mother before she comes to school. For 8 years, we have run a small club in that school, science club in that school. Extremely. 3 years back, Durga made this as part of the school science project. What is this? Just like a small box. Cut the base, so it's like a tube. This is the lid. Make an off-center hole in the lid. Put two safety pins, tape them. Put a needle and a small turbine. Very simple. I'm just going to screw on the lid. And if I just move this bottle in a glass of water, as I move it in, water will come into the bottle. It will expel air. And so Today, the world over, it's called the bottle turbine. We put Durga's photograph, her actual model, and the Maharashtra Times, which is equivalent of the Times of India in Marathi. They put a photograph. She stood second in her school, 94% marks in her high school, and they said, help this girl. And they're very good-hearted people in our city. 517 ranging from 20 rupees to 20,000 rupees. In a glittering function, Professor Mashelkar, only two fellows of the Royal Society, one is Professor Govind Sarup, the other is Professor Mashelkar, and he came from a very humble background. His mother was a housemaid, and he made it big. So the right person, and he gave Durga a check of 7 lakh rupees, which had been put into a bank account, and she gets 7,000 rupees every month to personal house. Thank you very much.